what will they bring us? And that's what we will try to bring over today in the presentation. Key in our story is that we will first talk shortly about the impact of workforce management. After that, we move on more to the quality of workforce management, the process itself. How do you determine what is a good workforce management approach? We will move then to the topic of what then really this all means, this process, when we transfer it to work at home, the challenges we see, the things we want to give you as food for thought to decide on to how to organize successfully in your organization. And as Roger mentioned, at the end, we would like to give you the opportunity to bring any questions forward you would like to bring on this topic. Hopefully we can all address of them. If there are questions which require a little bit more time, we're more than happy to, after this session, arrange follow-ups with you guys to discuss your specific challenges you face or questions you have. That all being said, let's make a start then to go and take a look to a process. What really is the impact of workforce management to our organization? Besides the millions of spreadsheets, the numbers of data, and all the things these guys work with, what does it really bring for operation? Important is then first to understand well what the workforce management process looks like. Now, for those who are in this session, no worries. We're not going to talk to every detail because, as my colleagues always say, if I start to tell passionate about the workforce management process, I can talk for hours. That's not the intent of today. But what is key to understand is the complexity on one hand, but also the involvement of operation to each of these parts of the workforce management cycle and how it pays back to operational excellence. We all know the steps of a workforce management process. You see them here in the blue blocks. We have forecasting, and forecasting gives us projections, which we use to define our capacity planning, making sure that we have the right amount of people available to handle our customer requests. But at the same time, forecasting is connected to our scheduling, making sure that we have the right amount of people, of course, in place at exact the right moment, with the right skills, with the right also non-productive activity scheduled, because it is not only the customer which we need to address in a schedule, their needs, but we also look to the needs of a business to coach and develop our staff to hold breaks and so on. And although we all design that very well, and we have good specialists probably in our company spending hours and hours doing the most accurate possible forecasts, getting the right people in place, doing beautiful schedules, real-time management is still the one which needs to fix everything what's left, all the gaps, all the things which deviate from reality. But to do this successful, they first of all need a lot of information from operations. They need to know very well what operations is doing, changing in their processes, what keeps customers busy, customer trends, customer behavior. At the same time, it gives us as an operation a lot of valuable information, because workforce management doesn't only tell us when people should be in, but also should we consider maybe a different type of training because we need more people to be upskilled for other skills. Do we have really the ability in our staff to have the right people in place at the right moment so that our customers experience a very fluent interaction with us, a good level of service or continuity? Now, this process we will now leave behind, but keep this picture in mind when we go through the rest of our presentation to realize the interconnection between operation and the different angles of workforce management. Key topic of this presentation in this webinar is all about what is in the relationship between workforce management, which feels quite often as some sort of operational planning department, and the experience of the customer. Now, for the level of you guys are aware of the Kano model, we use that normally within COPC to express the needs of a customer and how do we achieve customer satisfaction. What you see in the graph presented here is that there is a group of things which are must-be's, things which we need to address in a customer care environment to be successful and to gain customer experience. If these things are not in place, then automatically customer satisfaction will often result in a customer dissatisfaction. You can never achieve satisfied customers. Important things related to workforce management are items like accessibility. So can people even reach us? Do people have the opportunity to reach us at the moment of their convenience? But also handle time or hold time, how long your interaction takes. If for a simple request, you hold on the line for far too long, you as a customer never will be satisfied. So despite there are much more must-bes, which are not directly related to workforce management, it are these three which we see as must-bes to be identified from a workforce management point of view. We as workforce management have a big influence on these. We need to enable the operation to achieve accessibility and have a good grip on their handle time and hold times. If we then look to things we call satisfiers, so the more you give to the customer of this, the better, and quite often that are quality related items. So the quicker we solve an issue for the customer in one attempt, or more often we solve it straight away, the better, and the better quality we deliver. Now on the first view, you would say, what's the role of workforce management on this? But we should not forget that besides making sufficient space and schedule for all kinds of coachings, ad hoc coachings, what we want to do, additional trainings, roundtables, focus groups, you name it, if workforce management doesn't do their work properly to allocate the staff and create sufficient space for these activities to take place, we will give ourselves a pain in the quality in the long run. The same applies when you think about what first happens when it's very busy. If we completely misplanned our schedules, we have not well forecasted, it automatically results in high pressure volumes on times, and that impacts again our occupancy. And if an occupancy, so the occupied agents, if that's very high, there is some sort of stress. So agent starts to go cut corners, which I think for all of us count, your work doesn't get better if the pressure is too high, but also the other way around. If we're just everywhere overstaffed, what happens with agents? They get at some sort of bored, they start to do other things because they have so much available time between calls. So even the other way around, having very low occupancy, we see quite often resulting in challenges in the quality or even issue resolution. If we think about that concept and we want to further translate what workforce management does towards the impact of customer experience, let's take a look to these four building blocks we just discussed. If we think first about forecasting, which has just as an objective always the accuracy of predictions and forecasting the future to come, their impact on operations is mainly on, will they well calculate based on these forecasts how much workload we're going to handle? If they make mistakes, the chance we will have backlogs, we will not have the ability to handle the customer's request on the moment they desire. This automatically will impact all our service metrics. It has a direct impact to our service level, to our average speed of answer, and so on. But also on our efficiency, and efficiency you can always translate into cost. The less good we forecast, the less efficiently we can schedule, and therefore more cost we make to make customer care working as part of the product or service we deliver to the customer. Another impact forecasting has is it needs to provide you guys with a very clear view on what's the absenteeism and other shrinkage elements doing. Do we know very well how our agents are going to behave in the future, what will overcome to them? And can we in that way protect our service to happen? Because the fact is people will be absent from time to time. A fact will be that people will arrive late, have outages to deal with, or we have activities to plan. It means that we need to guarantee that the customer is not impacted by it and service can still be granted. If you move to capacity management, it's all about effective use of our resources. We have just always a limited amount of agents, limited people with certain skills. How do we well enough will address them? How will we make sure that we make the right recruitment decisions as an operation? So when do we need new staff? When do we need to start to train them then as well? And do we have capacity for that available? But also, what type of agents do we need? With which profile? What will be the impact of these new hires to our performance? And how do we make sure that there's enough staff available for nesting, for coaching them, and so on? So capacity management is more than just a simple balance. It's also about making sure that we can allocate all the demands we have as business, the demands of the customer, or even the demand of your client in case you're an outsourcer, within a budget. Scheduling becomes then the balance of optimal staffing versus demand. So can we staff our people as good as possible to when the customer wants us to be available? Because key is a customer needs to be able to reach us, and with a short waiting time is preferably for them. So scheduling comes down to helping with all the requests operations we'll have for coachings, for trainings, but also the preferences of our agents, which are part of staff engagement and staff satisfaction. How can we all bring that together with not forgetting the client, the customer? So again, the whole process, forecasting, capacity management, and scheduling is everywhere touching the ability we have to achieve service towards our customers, to achieve an efficient way of handling, so effectively. And you should not forget here that we not only talk about just our maybe our first line of business, but we also talk about how is the front line connected to our back offices, to our escalation lines of businesses. Because if we don't plan well, for example, our tier two or our escalation team, our senior teams, that has an impact on how our frontline can work. So if all these alignments which workforce management can help you with are not well in place, it automatically negatively impacts your service and efficiency, which are main drivers towards customer satisfaction. And there real-time management comes into place because they try to make sure that for everything what we've planned, that it's executed as well as possible, but also adjusted to what is changing over time. Just to bring into picture the link, it's more than clear that customer experience is maybe not 100% driven by workforce management, but they are one of the key enablers so that just operation are capable even of achieving customer satisfaction by delivering a good quality and issue resolution. What does that then really mean? How do we can get to workforce management in a qualitative way? Because just a simple planning is quite often not helping you, but also telling yourself, do we have a real good workforce management process? Are we in control, or what should we do to make it work better? COPC believes in a regime always of having a good process, but especially measure and control the outputs. Check if your process is really providing you with the appropriate quality, accuracy to build on. Because if a forecasting is, for example, completely inaccurate, why would you follow it then? You're going in the wrong direction. We all know that a forecast is structurally wrong. That's a simple way of saying in workforce management. But the clue is get as close as possible. Now for that, the COPC standard requires a couple of metrics normally, but in this case, I present to you the full set of metrics we need to take a look at, including the ones we just recommend as best practices in the industry. If we look to forecasting and capacity management, the main metrics are about, first of all, our scheduling forecast accuracy. What we mean with that, how well did we forecast it when we created the schedule, our volume, our AHT shrinkage, but also our concurrency when it's about chat and the amount of simultaneously chats to handle. If we forecast these accurate, then we know that we as scheduling, real-time management and operations can trust on our schedules. That if I schedule six people, that it will be sufficient because we know the forecast is pretty accurate. If already the forecast is completely off, schedulers automatically will start to overstaff. Real-time management will be very careful with the risk that you will end up or with very low efficiency, or because we can't anticipate on the big fluctuations with a poor service towards our customer. On another level, we also use always staffing forecast accuracy. It's already in the word staffing. Staffing stands for capacity management because we make hiring decisions in our capacity plan and I cannot out of a sudden fix 10 extra people if I need them. So an accurate capacity plan, or at least knowing how accurate your capacity plan is crucial. We prefer that you then measure that, for example, in the hours or FTEs, which you calculate in your capacity plan. How accurate was that? Could we make a well-educated guess based on our capacity plan? Could we make well-decided recruitment decisions? But there's more. Because forecast accuracy or metrics like that, people quite often measure in some shape or form. What we more often don't see is things like schedule quality. How well are we able to adjust our schedules to the demand which the customer gives us in a way? They tell when they call, we know how long the call we're gonna take or the email will be to handle, and we know our service level. So we can try to match that, but we need to have some sort of quantification. How good are we optimizing our schedules? For that, we will have schedule quality, and I will come back to that in one of our next slides. Real-time management is much more watching to their service KPIs, of course, and they can be easily held accountable for metrics like service level, average speed of answer, and abandonment rate that express their success. But we should not forget to also look to something like a program level metric of occupancy. It's up to real-time management to keep adjusting schedules and put offline activities in there to as much as possible user hours effectively. So it's a balance between service level and occupancy here. And schedule adherence, of course. A part of the role remains to just make sure that what we all have scheduled, that it's implemented as intended. And for that, they need to make sure and grant that the hours are there. This last one is also quite often used, of course, for the outsourcing organizations who need to commit to their client in a certain way of delivering the hours. All with the idea to make sure that we deliver service and have accessibility for customers towards our customer care. So a quick brief to these metrics. If you know the inaccuracy well enough, as I said, for scheduling, it helps you to take the right precautions in your capacity. Should I overstaff a little bit because it's very difficult for us to forecast? Should I make sure that we have more flexibility in our staff? When you work with a metric like schedule forecast accuracy, and you see two examples here projected on the slide on the right, the first step is always making sure that whatever upper and lower limits you set, that are the green and the orange lines you see here, to first make sure that you become predictable, making sure that the more intervals or days of the month, you will be between these two lines. In the beginning, it doesn't matter if that means that you allow yourself 10 or 20% being over or under. It all starts by making sure which bandwidths are we sure of that will happen most often. So for example, 80% of the times. At the same time, we need to make sure that you, after that's in control, you are more between these two lines, that you narrow the bandwidth. So the uncertainty, the risk will be reduced. The other metrics are about schedule quality, as I said. And schedule quality is a bit of a weird name, you could say, because the higher the number we calculate, the worse it is. Because what the metric is doing, it looks to your schedule, to your requirement and what you have staffed. And the difference of this is calculated as an absolute number. And we just compare that to the total requirement. So if I was two people overstaffed and I was another interval two people understaffed, in total, I had a waste of, let's say, four people compared to my requirement. And I divide that by my total requirements to get a percentage. And there's the lower the better. So if you want to compare your schedules, how they develop, this is the trick to go. Of course, more metrics are available, but we just want to give you a grasp on this. Now much more moving to what we really are about here, because the impact of working at home, it changed our process. It changed our approach and way of working. For that, it's first important to understand, where are we now? A lot of organizations made that move quickly to working from home as some sort of business continuity response. Our sites being closed, people need to work from home. It was just a little part of the industry which was already working from home, but even for them, it was not normal to have everyone working from home or even having permanent support that people were working all week from home. People were still coming back sometimes in the office to get coached, to get trained, and so on. In this model, now everyone is working close to the hub, close to the office. So lines are short in case of any issues. We see now more and more that people going back sometimes to hubs again, to the office for parts of days. But with the rise of COVID now again, people start to move back again to working fully from home. So it's some sort of interaction all the time. And the decision is, where do we go towards the future as a company? Will we also post-COVID decide to have people sometimes coming back to the office? And what does that mean for our scheduling, for our forecasting? Or do we maybe decide to completely leave people as much as possible working from home and not even that close to the hub anymore, but they can be everywhere across the country? Or would you decide to just even have no office users at all anymore? This is a decision, a strategic decision of companies, but we have to translate that for workforce management, what it means, and see the chances and opportunities. So I think we all realize that in some shape or form, work at home is here to stay, which means that we need to move from business continuity approaches to a more fundamental approach, which gives chances, but also gives some threats which we need to address. I think what is important to see here is that there is an impact now in the organization caused by the influence of COVID and the abrupt way that people need to work from home and the disruption that gives in all kinds of processes, different types of questions from customers and so on. Well, at the same time, there are things which are here to stay, where work at home in general is impacted. An example is, at this moment, absenteeism and attrition show completely different trends than we're used to. But of course, the pandemic is causing a part of this. Well, if you stay working from home, there can be a complete opposite effect. So we need to realize that the data we see now is partly polluted by the whole COVID impact. The same you can see for example, AHT, but also in numbers we use for after-call worker utilization, because we need to find a new way of doing the coachings and informal sessions become, for example, more formal and scheduled. If we want to express that, we did some research already on the data we have so far, which we've seen from all the, in this case, I choose all the OSPs, which we have audited, so all the outsourced partners, companies like Teleperformances, Transcoms, Concentrixes, across Europe and the Middle East and Africa, to take a look, what is the impact we see in their data, to see some trends. And the first thing we see already that there are some pattern shifting compared to previous years when you look to absenteeism. If you look to the upper graph, you see around March, of course, the kick-in of COVID started to hit the European sites. And we've seen almost immediately after a spike in absenteeism arising. Now, it's not that people normally would think people are working from home, so they would later call in sick, of course. Here we see that it even was not only people who were sick, but also people need to go to test themselves on COVID and need to be, for that, not present. They need to support their family and friends and relatives for which they were calling in sick, or we had just a higher peak of people who were infected themselves. What we see as soon as they work from home structurally, if you take the COVID effect out, is that the absenteeism is lower. And you start to see that a little bit in July and August already, month 7 and 8, the line starts to go equally. Of course, now with a pandemic heating up again, we will probably see a new spike. Maybe it follows the normal September peak. But that's the analysis you would like to do. Attrition is the other one, because there's one thing. The first thing what happens when people get uncertain about jobs normally and other crises, we've seen, of course, people less moving out of the company. People stay where they are. What we've seen is an extreme dip in, let's say, April, May, and June when it comes to attrition. But we see some sort of catch up now at the end of summer. People still moving from a job. Everyone was a bit relieved. So interesting trends to see that next to previous crises, we see now even a slightly different pattern. How is workforce management going to anticipate on this? How are we going to make maybe patterns based on the previous crisis we have seen? When we review also more other metrics on efficiency, it's interesting to take a look to what happens on average handle time. In some of the industries, it's very logically what happened straight away after COVID kicked in. See the first example in the graph where this is from a travel services company, from an airline. Of course, immediately after March, their AHT start to spike. People have much more complex questions, longer complaints, voucher discussions, and so on. So it was these industries where we expected to see this picture. But at the same time, we saw the same effect arising in some of the technical support clients we service, which was not always that logical because people were already being supported online. They were already supported in this environment. There was nothing changed. So our question was, can we explain then why the handle time on so many of these technical support environments is increasing in some shape or form? One of the biggest explanations we found is the experience we have with working from home. Because we compared sites which are servicing the same clients or the same type of customers and looked into, okay, one is already having experience with working at home in their company or on this client and others don't. And you see the adjustability to a new environment and questions was completely different. The existing user of work at home didn't have any impact. They almost didn't experience real big impact when it came to their handle time. They were able to adjust to the fact that now everyone needed to work from home and they know how to coach and develop people on that. They also recruited the staff for it. Well, in other cases, like the ones we didn't have that experience, we saw much more increase of the AHT. And it was also longer there to stay. because it will take a while before everything is managed away, which is the impact from working at home, which is maybe your systems aren't ready for it, your knowledge bases, but it could also be you have a lot of informal processes in place, and especially support, floor walkers, which were normally there and are now not present anymore, but on chat. But also limitations to your hardware. Do you have two screens at home? Can all applications run over a VPN? And just a human factor. People are not used to be not managed and not overwatched, probably take longer to adjust. So what does that mean then for each part of the process? If we look to what is changing at this moment from working from home, there are a couple of things to consider when you look to forecasting and capacity management. You need to adjust for a new reality where, first of all, your arrival patterns will change, not only just because we work from home, maybe our opening window is different, but especially all customers work from home. So what is their changing behavior? Will they call you on different times? Will they call for different reasons on different times? Maybe in the past, a complaint you raised in the evening when you were at home. Now you think, I will call the customer care already to complain. And I pause my work for a moment and I will work on a little bit later. People manage more their own agenda. We also see a shift in the balance between digital and human assisted channels. So people use much more now because they're forced to it by closure of shops and retail environments to use digital channels. Is that here to stay with your types of customers? That's what you have to take a look at. Average handle time is changing by customer influence because they have the time or different types of questions, as well as our staff, how they handle the transaction. Maybe somebody's not all the time telling how long they're already on after call work or watching over their shoulder. Another thing is case duration, which is going to change, especially if you handle back office cases or when you look to chats. Now everyone is more working from home. It's easier to in between just respond to something. You have the forms close by, a copy of your passport is easily made. So you will see that waiting for customers to reply to your question, the chance that you get email more as a chat almost is more likely. So you need to see what your customer is doing with his responses and how he prioritizes it, which maybe requests you also to review your patterns again. In forecasting, the next part is shrinkage and attrition. I mean, of course, our customers change, so our staff changes. Working from home, quite often we see that absenteeism is then lower in the long run because people are more likely to still work even if they not feel that well. But also, there is less chance that you are late, of course. At the same time, we have to plan much differently our non-productive activities like training and so on, because things which were informal become formal. Talking just to an agent who is sitting next to me is not possible anymore. I need to take him offline shortly because he's otherwise receiving his calls. It gives a different situation. If we look to recruitment, the most important thing is there any change going to be in the type of agent we hire now? Now we need people who can work from home. And what does that mean for the effectiveness of training? So if I hire a class of 10, how much people will pass? And is there a difference on their learning curves? How quickly will they learn on distance and when they have a remote coach? All the learning curves and speed to proficiencies we just analyzed before, we need to re-update that with new data. In scheduling, it gives a lot of extra opportunities in a way. Making sure that you have now people working from home, it takes away, of course, things like travel time to the office or even schedules with buses bringing people to the office in certain countries, acceptable times for people to come to office. But also it gives the opportunity for people to work smaller bricks in a schedule on different times when we need them, adjust much more to peaks. The use of what we call split shifts, maybe you work in the peak in the morning and you do late in the afternoon a part of the shift, becomes much more possible if it fits in your labor laws. But also it gives the opportunity to ask much more for a short extension of shift in overtime or easier downscaling because people are already home. So if you tell them to just, can we shorten your shift a day a little bit? They think like, yeah, it's okay, I don't have travel time, it's all fine. I can immediately do something in my own time. So you can play much more with flexibility. And another advantage for those who were in buildings limited by their amount of seats, that's the way now, people work from home. So you can more adjust your schedules to peaks. It all depends, of course, on what your staff is willing to, and as well as what you can do in labor codes. But what we generally see as a shift with working from home is that the whole block scheduling, so everyone is scheduled equally to their team manager or in the same time to have teams be in this in the center at the right moment, that really changes. It's not that much needed anymore, that alignment. Still, you want an overlap with the team leaders from time to time, but now people work from home. We can much more give it to what's working for them and what's working for us as a business. The best approach we see there is scheduling based on availability, as we call it, which means an agent gives an availability when he wants to work based on rules we set on how much hours he should give compared to his contractual hours, considering, of course, all contractual obligations, but also when we just need them. When we need them in the morning, they can collect more points by selecting these hours than when they go for shifts where we less need them. And within the availability they give us, we can freely schedule them. Within, again, rules which we agreed between staff, HR, and workforce management. Agents get the opportunity to update that from week to week, so they can adjust it to their own work-life balance within our framework, at the same time that reduces your absenteeism in the end. Especially when you also provide people with the opportunity then to keep also changing their shifts between people. So a lot of options are there to just make advantage of it by at least reconsidering your actual scheduling approach. And does it fit the flexibility I could gain now with working from home without, of course, let people run away because you make it too flexible and too unpredictable for them, but in a healthy balance and using the advantages this situation gives to us. The last group is really about real-time management, because there's especially a lot to consider. In your real-time management environment, it's key to take a look, how are the lines of communication working? I can't walk around anymore over the floor. I don't have people on the floor even anymore. Even if I had the central command center, I don't have these team managers anymore who can tick them on the shoulder and ask them something. So you need to have some sort of chat application in place or any type of other interaction tool in which you can directly talk between real-time management and an agent, and which they also will immediately see. But what if that agent is having difficulties and not getting logged in, or he is away from desk, making some coffee, taking care of the kids, of the pets, whatever. I can't reach them. You can't now see where they are. So how are we going to approach this? So approaches and lines of communication also for calling in for absence and for other adjustments, they need to be clarified and renewed, probably digitalized in your WFM tool, in your CRM tool, but make optimal advantage of it and organize it. Next to it, we need an approach to handle technical outages in general. How are we going to reduce the impact? Because real-time management and IT, how do we inform them about an outage, first of all? Because if I don't have an internet connection, can agents call in with their mobile? Is there some WhatsApp group maybe where they're reported into? How do we know of it? How can we troubleshoot on distance? And also update your risk assessment to see what challenges there are. How are you going to replace systems? What happens when an internet service provider goes down and almost all your agents are having their internet subscription with them? Did you assess even who is all using which internet service provider? Especially for the telcos in this call, what if all your agents are customer with your company? You get extra volume offered because you have an outage, but also your own agents are not capable to get any connection. You need to deploy also clear procedures for ad hoc requests, because an operation wants to change, of course, things all day long in a schedule, which is great. But we need to make sure that it's all planned well, because we can't see anymore who's sitting everywhere and if we have enough agents online. So all the changes for extra coachings, meetings, callbacks, probably do it by chat as well, or again, automated in your workforce management tool. But it needs to be differently addressed in this case. Also, managing productivity and schedule adherence, because as we already said, how do you reach out to someone? But in general, we can't now just say, hey, this person is already long in their after call work. Take a look at their desk. What's going on? It's much more difficult. You still should focus as real-time management on the individual schedule adherence and seeing how people behave. But maybe you can do it much less real time, because if somebody's not there, you cannot reach them anyway. But it should much more focus beyond, hey, at the end of the day, who is an outlier with his adherence? Who is not delivering the hours, and how can we solve that? So instead of waiting a week or 2 weeks or even a month and you review the schedule conformance, you need now to interact quicker. We have also to realize that work from home at the beginning most of the time increases the offline time, because more informal things like consulting your neighbor normally for asking quicker question goes much quicker than when you need to chat with a second line. So we need to make time for that, put that into the schedules, reserve for that, and try to solve as much as possible of the problems agents face in handling the interactions to make sure that your knowledge base is up to speed, to identify problems with the availability of floor support and so on. The other thing is that we have, of course, the opportunity to get extra people in. That's the big opportunity we have, but how are we going to get that in place? How are we going to organize that we can call people, hey, it's busy, we need some extra staff. Are we going to work with standby shifts? Because then I can rapidly get someone online. But if you just call me, and yes, I work from home, but I'm just to the supermarket now because today I don't have to work or I'm out, I still have that delay, which I had before as well. So maybe you want to consider standby shifts to be ready or some sort of response time. Quite often it only costs you money because you need to pay for these people, their response shifts. Are there any limitations in general that you can make use of it? And what is with shift duration? Because working from home, we all know it now, we work from home, it's easier to make a longer shift. The same for agents, they easier could choose to just say, I will take some overtime. But we need to keep in mind, of course, regulations and limitations. The thing what is quite often forgotten with real-time management is to keep a very good look on all the exits of, let's say, the first line. So consult, transfer, and escalation teams and staff. In work at home, it's more important than ever to make sure that these lines of business, these second lines or third lines, are there, that they're equipped, and that they're monitored on their availability or their reachability. If that's not part of your command center, you have a big chance that you create queues of your own agents, not be able to reach out to them, or being longer busy in handling the cases, which you don't see, you don't notice it. You don't see them just watching around, looking very busy in all kinds of knowledge bases. So because you have less visibility, it's important to make sure that we get more visibility on these support teams and make sure they're well-equipped, well-scheduled, and that they have a high performance in their service level and availability. Now, this is a very quick run through a lot of different criteria and things we've seen so far. I will be honest with you, this is just what we build up on in these last couple of months, because COPC had before as well guidance when it comes to work at home. But now everyone is using it, the best practices start to come around. We're here, of course, to keep developing this, but we wanted to give you already this insight in where we are now and what considerations we think you should take, but also how workforce management is the glue, as we say it, or the key role to make a success of your work at home as well. It should not longer be just the team who make a spreadsheet with a schedule. They are here the enabler of customer experience because they enable you to have a good service, good efficiency while people work from home, which also guarantee you to deliver quality. That all being summed up, I realize it was a lot of information and a lot of things to read through probably at a later stage again, but do some of you at this moment have any questions for us which we could answer to give you some extra insights?
Thanks, Jeffrey. I don't know about you guys, but I found that amazingly insightful. I saw this presentation this morning and I went through it and thought, I hadn't thought of that. I hadn't considered that. So well done, Jeffrey. Amazing amount of information together. We have, thanks to the audience here, we have some questions. Mm-hmm. I hope they won't confuse you, Jeffrey. First one we have is, did I understand you correctly when you said you consider quality delivered to be, consider quality delivered to the customer to be driven by workforce management?
Because quality in itself is of course enabled by everything we do in quality management, coaching and training. But to make sure that that can happen and that we can maintain the knowledge and skills of our agents, workforce management needs to give the appropriate amount of time, needs to be sure that we can allocate it on time, that we not postpone all our e-learnings because service level is under pressure. They need to make sure that we optimally use our time and occupy it with also the activities for quality. So as I said, occupancy high is automatically a quality loss, but occupancy low, we should use that to address all these activities to gain quality in the team.
Excellent, thank you. Second one, you mentioned schedule quality as an important metric for the performance of workforce management and in particular scheduling. Are there benchmarks you can provide?
Now, providing a benchmark is for some metrics very difficult, and schedule quality is one of them. As I said, the lower the number, the better, but it depends on the level of flexibility you are allowed in your country. If I take, for example, countries like the Netherlands, or we've also seen the same in other flexible countries with their labor codes, you can go to a very precise percentage of maybe 1 or 2% deviation in your schedule because you are so flexible in scheduling with short shifts and activities. If you have just single skilled people who have to work business to business fixed hours, we already know that it's much more difficult to optimize it. So what I would say is look to your own organization at this moment where your schedule quality stands and try to simulate different scenarios and different actions and see their impact. If you can bring down their percentage week over week, month over month. And we've seen great examples of a lot of our clients using these percentages and these measures by gaining schedule quality. And it's good because schedule quality, you can immediately translate into cost. Every percent you save of waste is just money you just earned back for the company.
Thanks. Do we really need to change our approaches for this disruption if we will return to the previous situation after all the COVID is finished?
Once again, you interrupted, Roger. I could not hear you.
Sorry. The question is, do we really need to change our approaches for this disruption if we will return to the previous situation after COVID?
Even when your decision as an organization would be as soon as COVID is gone, and we believe in that our people need to be back in the building for whatever possible reason, that's fine, but doesn't mean that your customer isn't changed, because the reality will be that a large group of customers, which we face, now have a different work environment. Companies choose to have more flexibility working from home, maybe only 1 or 2 days, or maybe for a longer period. So it has changed also for your customer. So I think no organization has the ability to completely ignore it. I think you only need to see to which scale it impacts my customers and to which level we let our own business model be adjusted and then translate it into action. But doing nothing is definitely not the right way to go at this moment. The world has changed. We're now already 6-7 months into COVID reality. At least I think 6 to 7 months to go. But people get used to it. So also your approaches would need to change.
Thank you. Interesting question. What should I do if I don't have much usable historical data to adjust my forecast to with the new changing reality?
I think we all face that, isn't it? I mean, nobody knew what was going to happen when COVID came around the corner, and we need to anticipate very quickly with almost no data to our availability. What I can just recommend you is to use the same approach as which you would normally do with a new line of business to be opened. Some data, as I said, as an example, you can maybe use previous crises. How would attrition behave? How is absenteeism behaving? You can get some clues from previous crises and how your agents behaved. But customer behavior is much more difficult to understand now. So what then the best thing to do is almost like some sort of scrum methodology, bring your forecast in place, try to make your best educated guess and do frequent postmortems, almost on a weekly basis, learn from every week of data you get or every month. In the beginning, you will be less inaccurate, we understand. But now you should already have a couple of months of data where you can work with. Maybe then not do your normal 13 weeks or your normal 1 year comparison average for forecasting, but use the last couple of weeks, the last couple of months, short-term trending would be my recommendation.
Thank you. How can I quantify the financial impact to operations of a better performing workforce management?
Now, this one, I think I already learned at the beginning of my workforce management career. One of my managers really tried to convince me, if you can save me money, I can justify that we have a whole team of you guys working here. And the easiest way to quantify, I think, the success of workforce management into dollars, euros, or whatever currency is mainly making sure that you have measures in place like schedule quality, because you can there show the waste you minimize in a schedule. And if it normally was 15% and you bring it down to 10, you can just say 5% of our capacity, I could or relocate to handle more customers, which is also still a financial gain, or I could even reduce it, less hours to spend. In real-time management, we use for that occupancy much more. A schedule has a certain occupancy you can achieve with it, and then it's up to real-time management to get to there. And every percent occupancy increase is just dollars or is an increase in extra customers we can handle. So reducing of waste is the easiest way to quantify it. And I would say then our occupancy and schedule deviation or inefficiency are your best friends.
Excellent. Well, we have one more question, and it's perhaps the most insightful question that we've had all day. It's from one of our regular clients, and he's saying, what was hanging on the wall with before behind you on the hooks?
It was very simple. I have a partner who's doing yoga. So for that reason, she needs these eyes to put ropes on. That's it.
In point of fact, the real answer is operations management. Thank you for your question, Maciek.
Thank you very much, Maciek.